Hello, my name is Pascal Cossard. I work at the Pasteur Institute. And my goal today is to show you that Listeria monocytogenes is a multifaceted model in different areas of biology and a reference. We use it as a model to understand how bacterial pathogens establish an infection. Our goal is to decipher. What are the specific attributes of this organism? And what are the mechanisms underlying a successful infection? We sincerely believe that at a period where antibiotic resistance is really increasing, it's absolutely critical to generate new therapeutics to understand what are really the different steps of an infectious process. So my lab is thus using different approaches. We use genetics and genomics to identify virulence factors. We use cell biology to understand what are the molecular mechanisms in which they are involved. And we validate our results in relevant animal models with the final goal to understand what is a human infection. So Listeria was not discovered by Louis Pasteur and was not discovered by his competitor Robert Koch. It was discovered by Murray in Cambridge, England. In Listeriology, there are important dates. The first is in the early 60s when McAnes discovered that protection against Listeria and recovery from infection is not due to an antibody response but is due to a T-cell response. And since that, Listeria is used as a model in immunology. The second important date is in the late 80s when three groups in the world started to combine molecular biology and cell biology to address the virulence of Listeria. And this was the beginning of what we have called cellular microbiology. The third important date is in the early 2000s when in the framework of a European consortium, we determined the complete genome sequence of Listeria monocytogenes and that of Listeria innocua, and this was the beginning of the pogenomic period. The last period is now, when we have shown that Listeria is able to somehow control the epigenetic regulation of the transcription program of the host. And this is the beginning of the epigenetics and infection field, really an emerging field. So Listeria infection starts by the ingestion of contaminated food product. The bacteria reach the intestinal lumen. They cross the intestinal barrier, and then they are able to disseminate to deeper organs. In pregnant women, to the placenta. In immunocompromised people, to the brain. So this generates brain infection, or it generates premature deliveries or abortions. So listeriosis is really an interesting infection. It's a model of infection. One should have in mind that listeriosis is a problem of public health, but it's also of veterinary importance. It's also a major concern in the food industry, because of the fact that Listeria can contaminate the food product. Finally, as I will show today, Listeria is a model for the study of intracellular parasitism. It's really a tool in cell biology. When we started to work on Listeria in the late 80s, we had chosen Listeria because it's an intracellular bacterial pathogen, and we realized that intracellular pathogens are responsible for major health problems. So Listeria monocytogenes is an invasive pathogen, which means that it is able to enter in cells which are normally non-phagocytic. So it first adheres, and then it's internalized in a vacuole, it escapes from this vacuole, and it starts to replicate and to recruit actin and polymerize actin, so that it can move inside the cell and spread from one cell to the other. So the different products, so you see that by electron microscopy, but you can also look at this process by video microscopy. You see here two bacteria which are moving inside the cytosol. You see here in this panel bacteria which are trying to reach the neighboring cells. And you see on the left a cell which is full of bacteria which are moving inside these cells. So the bacterial factors which are involved in all this process are, for the invasion, mostly internalin A and ENLB. For the lysis of the vacuole, the pore-forming toxin Listeriosin O and the two phospholipase PLCA and PLCB. The actin-based motility is mediated by ACTA. The lysis of the two-membrane vacuole of the second infected cell is also mediated by LLO and the two phospholipases. So the beauty of the system is that all the genes which are involved in the infectious process are co-regulated by a single protein, which is called PRFA. So PRFA is encoded in the locus, which encodes for Listeriosin O, ACTA, and the two phospholipase. PRFA also regulates the two invasion genes. And what is nice is that all these genes are co-expressed and co-regulated by PRFA, and they are all expressed at high temperature, the 37 degree temperature of your body. At low temperature, when the bacteria are in the environment, these genes are silent. And we realize that this is due to the fact that the 5' region of the message for PRFA can adopt at low temperature a secondary structure which prevents the ribosome to get access to the ribosome binding sites, the Shine-Nell-Darnaud sequence. So at low temperature, there is a stem and loop structure which can open at high temperature, and then the Shine-Nell-Darnaud sequence allows the ribosome to bind and to allow the translation of the message, the PRFA protein is made and there is virulence gene expression. So my first message is that Listeria virulence genes are thermoregulated via a thermosensor, and thermosensor has now been described in the case of Yersinia and Neisseria. When we discovered the RNA thermosensor, RNA was becoming to be very fashionable and very importantly recognized molecules. And we decided that we would focus some of our efforts on the identification of non-coding RNAs. At that stage, we had already sequenced the genome of monocytogenes and that of Listeria innocua. When we had done these sequences, our goal was to use these sequences to extract genes which would be present only in monocytogenes and absent in Listeria innocua, and which could be virulence, which could encode virulence factors. We also had in mind that we would carry out biodiversity experiments or global gene expression, but we did not know that we would be searching for small RNA or other type of non-coding RNAs. Well, the key step in our search for regulatory RNA was the use of tiling arrays. So we used Listeria-specific tiling arrays to search for small RNAs. So we grew bacteria in different types of conditions, extracted the RNA, and hybridized this RNA on the tiling array. And we were able to describe the Listeria transcriptional landscape during switch from saprophytism to virulence. We discovered 50 small RNA at that time, which were differentially expressed according to the condition in which they were bacteria had been grown. We were able to identify small RNA present in monocytogenes and absent in innocua. We were able to show that some of these RNA were highly expressed in blood, as you can see in green on this slide. And of course, we were able to describe for the first time the operon map of the bacteria. We found many, many interesting findings, and I would like to focus on novel antisense RNA elements. By our tiling array experiments, we were able to describe three long antisense RNA, which were encoded by the strand opposite to annotated operons. We also described 9 overlapping 3' UTRs. We also described 4 overlapping 5' UTRs, which was really a surprise. We had been very stringent in our analysis, and we decided to use another technique, which is RNA-seq, to identify non-coding regulatory RNAs. And we found different types of regulatory RNAs. Again, we found small non-coding RNAs. We found a series of 5' UTRs, riboswitches, or long 5' untranslated regions, which were acting as regulators. And we found antisense RNA. In fact, we found 2 categories of antisense RNAs, short ones or long ones. Short, which are opposite to one open reading frame, and long ones, which were overlapping divergent operons. In fact, we found several examples of long antisense RNAs acting, in fact, as antisense RNA for one open reading frame, but acting as an mRNA for the divergent operons. And we coined a new name for this type of structure, which is the excludon. So an excludon is a genetic locus where a long antisense RNA can act as an antisense and as a messenger RNA, regulating genes which are often with opposite or mutually exclusive functions. We found other novelties. For example, we found that short transcripts generated by riboswitches are not degraded. They can act as a regulatory small RNA. We found that in the case of the S-adenosine methionine riboswitch in Listeria. We also found that riboswitches can regulate non-coding antisense RNA. Riboswitches were described to regulate gene coding operons, but we found that the riboswitch can regulate the non-coding antisense RNA. And this is described on this slide. So this is the case of a B12 riboswitch, which regulates an antisense RNA. So here is the riboswitch, which is upstream of the non-coding antisense anti-POC-R. So this antisense regulates the expression of POC-R, which is the activator of the genes which are involved in the catabolism of propandiol. So in the absence of B12, there is no POC-R which is made. In the presence of B12, the riboswitch is bound to B12, so the transcript is short, and there is no antisense opposite to POC-R which is made and allows the expression of the propandiol utilization genes, which are thus expressed only in the presence of propandiol and B12. We found another example of a B12 riboswitch, which is regulating a non-coding RNA, and this non-coding RNA is a protein sequestering RNA. So this riboswitch is here. It is upstream of a non-coding RNA, which can sequester a regulatory protein called UDV. So in the absence of B12, there is a small RNA which is made, which sequesters UDV. In the presence of B12, the riboswitch prevents the expression of the whole small RNA. So there is no protein which can bind to this small RNA, and the protein is desequestered and can activate the U genes, the ethanolamine utilization genes. So in the presence of ethanolamine and in the presence of B12, the U genes are made and the bacterium is able to utilize ethanolamine. We have shown that the utilization of ethanolamine is critical for the pathogenesis. So I think the second take-home message is that regulation in bacteria is much more sophisticated than originally thought by people like Jacob and Monod when they presented their operon, and I think there are more surprises to come. I would like to switch totally gears and now go to the cell biology of the infectious process. Here is a bacterium which is entering into a mammalian cells. The membrane is remodeled, the cytoskeleton is rearranged. We have been analyzing this process for many years and have succeeded to identify the protein and the signaling events which are involved in this process. So, the bacterial proteins which are involved are internalin or INLA, and the second protein is INLB. Internalin or INLA interacts with the receptor, which is a protein called icaderin. So icaderin is a protein which normally maintains epithelia by icaderin-icaderin interaction. We have shown that internalin interacts with the human icaderin, but the interaction is very specific. Internalin cannot interact with the mouse icaderin, although the human icaderin and the mouse icaderin only differs at one position, which is this critical position that allows interaction between INLA and icaderin. So to address the role of internalin and icaderin, we decided to express the human icaderin in the mouse and to infect transgenic mouse to decipher what is the role of the interaction between INLA and icaderin. So you see on this slide the results of oral infection of wild-type mice and of human icaderin transgenic mice. In wild-type mice, if you infect with 5×10^10 bacteria, there is 0% mortality, and the same is true if you infect with internalin mutant. In human icaderin transgenic mice, if you infect with 5×10^10 bacteria, there is 100% mortality. If you infect with the same amount of bacteria mutant, there is no mortality. This key experiment has demonstrated that the interaction between internalin and icaderin is critical for a successful infection. Some of you may think that icaderin is engaged in icaderin-icaderin interaction at the level of an intestine and would not be accessible for the bacteria. My colleague Marc Lecuy and his student Yorgos Nikitas have shown that it is not the case. Icaderin is luminally accessible and can be accessible to the bacteria inside the intestine. So my third message is that the use of human icaderin transgenic mice has allowed to show that Listeria crosses the intestinal barrier via an internalin-icaderin interaction. This was the first time that transgenic mice were used in the case of a bacteria to demonstrate a specific step of infection. Of course, we have been interested to decipher all the signaling pathways which are involved in the entry process. So in cells where icaderin is present, the internalin interacts with icaderin and induces a signaling pathway which leads to actin polymerization. Key proteins are, for example, the RII complex. The RII complex is also involved in the entry of Listeria via the NLB protein. Indeed, in cells where icaderin is not present, even in cells where icaderin is present, the NLB protein is interacting with MET, an ubiquitous protein, which is in fact the receptor for the hepatocyte growth factor. So MET interacts with the NLB and generates a signaling cascade of events, which lead to actin polymerization. Another factor which is critical is this PI3 kinase. PI3 kinase is activated via different proteins, including this Cbl protein. In fact, after having discovered this pathway, we realized that Cbl is an ubiquitin ligase which has been described as critical for the ubiquitination of growth factor receptor when a downregulation is critical for the cell. So when a cell is activated by a growth factor, after the activation, there is a downregulation which is mediated by the phosphorylation and the ubiquitination of the receptor, which leads to the clathrin-mediated endocytosis of the receptor. We wondered whether INLB when it interacts with MET, is using the clathrin-mediated endocytosis machinery at one stage of the process. And this was totally against the dogma. The dogma says that the clathrin-mediated endocytosis is used for internalization of molecules or very small objects, but not for big objects, hysteria. However, we have shown that clathrin is recruited at the site of entry, and clathrin is required for the entry process. At that stage, we were wondering whether we were dealing with a specific point for the NLB-mediated entry of listeria, or if this was a general finding. And in fact, we found that in the case of the NLA pathway, this is also the case. There is an ubiquitination of the E-cadherin receptor. And what was also very interesting is that clathrin is also recruited by adherent bacteria. For example, the enteropathogenic E. coli, or EPEC, which are producing these pedestals in the intestinal epithelial cells, are somehow using clathrin for this process of pedestal formation. You see the bacteria in blue, you see the actin in red, and in between you see the clathrin, which is in green. And if you inhibit the clathrin, you inhibit the pedestal formation. So clearly the study of signaling events during entry of listeria into cells has led to the discovery of a new role for clathrin in orchestrating actin rearrangements. For time constraints, I don't have time to tell you, but we have been able to decipher what are the molecules which somehow link the clathrin to the actin cytoskeleton. Let's switch gears and discuss the actin-based motility. The actin-based motility of listeria was discovered by Tilney and Portnoy. And when they discovered this actin-based motility of listeria, a parallel between what happens at the back end of the bacterium and what happens at the leading edge of locomoting cells was rapidly made by cell biologists. You see here a cell which is chasing a bacterium, which is on the right, you see this cell chasing this poor bacterium, which will be phagocytosed. Well, a parallel is really true between the two phenomena. So we were lucky to show that there exists, to discover a mutant which was not able to make this very nice comet head. And this mutant was able to multiply, to make these internal colonies inside mammalian cells, but was not able to disseminate from one cell to the other. So this corresponded to a mutation in the ACTA gene. So the ACTA gene encodes for a protein called ACTA. ACTA is a protein which goes on the surface of bacteria. This is the dimer, and as shown by Matthew Welsh in the lab of Tim Mitchison, ACTA recruits a complex of seven proteins, which is called the R23 complex. So the R23 complex binds to the ACTA protein and recruits actin monomer, generating branched filaments on preformed actin filaments. The same scenario occurs at the leading edge of removing cells, where you have SCARWAS family proteins, which are able to recruit the R23 complex and generate these branched actin filaments. The beauty of the system is that ACTA and WAS family proteins are similar at the level of the primary sequence. They have a similar R23 binding site, and this is a magnificent example of evolution, a convergent evolution. So clearly, the bacterial protein ACTA was instrumental in the discovery of the function of the R23 complex, the major actin nucleator in mammalian cells. Unfortunately, this movie doesn't seem to work, but we have been very recently able to, by cryo-electrotomography in collaboration with a group of Wolfgang Mobeister in Munich, to show that the cytoplasmic tail of listeria moving inside cells are made of bundles of nearly parallel, hexagonally packed actin filaments with a spacing of 12 to 13 nanometers. Listeria is not the only bacterium able to move from cell to cell. There are other bacteria which do so. For example, Shigella flexneri has a protein on its outer membrane, which is called ICAC or VRG, which does not act as actin, but recruits the NWASP protein, which itself will bind to the R23 complex and generate an actin tail, which is very similar to the actin tail of Listeria. But there is another bacterium which is making a different type of tail, and this bacterium is Rickettsia coenoe. So Rickettsia coenoe is an intracellular pathogen which is very difficult to work with, and when we were searching for the gene which was involved in the actin polymerization, we sequenced the genome and we found a protein which is similar to actin and that we named Rickettsia. Rickettsia is able to induce actin polymerization, but as shown by Matthew Welch again, Rickettsia is not the only protein able to polymerize actin. In the case of Rickettsia, there is another protein which is acting probably after the Rickettsia protein and which is regenerating these long filaments and which is this Ca2 protein. So the field was more or less a bit slowing down when septins enter in the game. Why septin? Well, we had been trying to decipher what are the host proteins involved in the early steps on infection by using a technique which is described on this slide. In fact, we had taken beads coated with either INLA or INLB, and these beads were able to enter into cells, and we purify the vacuoles containing these beads, and we decided to do 2D gels to see what are the proteins associated with either the vacuoles of INLA beads or the vacuoles of INLB beads. And we found that there was a protein which was present in the INLA, in the INLB vacuoles, but not INLA, and this protein was mass spec and was identified as a septin. So what are the septins? The septins are a family of GTP binding proteins which have been described for the first time as involved in septum formation, and you see that the septins are forming this ring at the septum in yeast. But they are increasingly recognized for other functions such as exocytosis, vesicle formation, vesicle trafficking in mammalian cells. They have been poorly studied because there are 13 human septin genes encoding 4 groups of septins with a relatively structured, so it's a complicated system. But they are very interesting. They form filaments, they form nonpolar filaments, which partially colocalize with either actin or with tubulins, depending on the cells. So we were interested to see whether septins were recruited at the site of entry, since they were associated with the vacuole. And as you can see here, septin 9 is nicely colocalizing with entering bacteria, but they do not strictly colocalize with actin. So when we started to do RNAi on the different septins, the result was that in some cases this would increase the entry, in some cases this would decrease the entry and started to be very complicated. So we decided to look at the role of septin in actin-based motility. And we could show that in fact the tails of actins were really circled by the circle of septin, which was very interesting. So then we did RNAi on these different septins, and we could not see any effect either on the speed of the bacteria or on the direction of the bacteria. But Serge Mastovi in the lab decided to also analyze this phenomenon in the case of Shigella-infected cells, and he made this very nice observation. First, that the septins are indeed recruited to the tails, but what Serge could show is that not all bacteria are making these very nice comet tails. Some of the bacteria are trapped in some kind of septin cages, as you can see here. So there are bacteria which are moving, like these bacteria, but there are these bacteria which are trapped in septin cages. So there is a choice of either polymerizing actin tails or becoming compartmentalized in septin cages. So these septin cages are really interesting. They are making these circles around the bacteria, And the septins do not strictly colocalize with actin, as you can see here. Sometimes you have some kind of nest of bacteria which are really forming these cages. So we looked at them more carefully, and you see that really they are making rings of septins around the bacteria. So clearly, septins entrap cytosolic bacteria in cages and they counteract the actin-based motility and the dissemination of the bacteria. We could show that you can increase the number of cage formation by treating cells with TNF-alpha. So this really inhibits the actin-based motility and the dissemination within tissues. So the take-home message is that septins can entrap cytosolic bacteria and prevent dissemination, and I refer to our article to show that there is a link between the beginning of the cage formation and the process of autophagy. As I told you at the beginning, I was going to cover several facets of the infectious process, and one of the facets is what is the role of the infection on mitochondria, or what is the role of mitochondria in infection. Why have we suddenly been interested in mitochondria? Well, mitochondria are organelles within cells which are important for energy production, ATP production. They are important for calcium buffering, and they are also the site of storage of pro-apoptotic components. But I have been mostly interested in mitochondria because I thought that they are this bean shape that you see in all textbooks. But one day I was giving a talk after somebody who talked about mitochondria and was showing that these mitochondria are in fact making this network. They are making some kind of filaments. They are highly mobile. They can fragment. They can fuse. They are very dynamic, and there are also defects associated with human diseases. And I was wondering what would be the role of mitochondria in infection and what would be the effect of mitochondria, of infection on mitochondria. So we have been studying that more carefully, and before showing you our results, I want to say that mitochondrial dynamics is well studied. And proteins involved in either the fusion or the fission have been clearly demonstrated and characterized. For the fusion, you have this 2-methylfusin protein and this OPA1 protein, which mediate the fusion of mitochondria with another mitochondria. You see here that the GFP, which is in this mitochondrial filament, is going to invade this second mitochondria. And the mitochondria can also fuse, fragment, and you see here. And this is due to a protein which is called DRP1, or dynamine-related protein 1. So we infected cells with listeria, and we could show that it causes mitochondrial fragmentation. So compared to untreated cells, cells treated with monocytogenes have their mitochondria which are totally fragmented. And this is not the case for listeria, when you incubate cells with listeria inocula. So we then wondered what was the factor which was inducing this fission, and we could show by using a variety of mutants that in the case of human mutant which is not producing listeriolysino, that there is no longer fragmentation, indicating that listeriolysino is probably critical for the fragmentation. So we then used recombinant LLO, and we could show that indeed this protein is mediating fragmentation. So LLO affects mitochondrial function, as you can see, with a loss in mitochondrial membrane potential, as revealed with this red marker, which disappears after 5 minutes of incubation with LLO. And there is also LLO-dependent decrease in intracellular ATP levels, as you can see with the wild-type Listeria monocytogenes, something which is not seen with the delta HL wild mutant, or a decrease in ATP level that you can see when you treat cells with LLO compared to untreated cells. So then, having shown that Listeria is inducing a fragmentation, We were wondering whether this was a benefit for the bacterium or if it was something which was not of a benefit for infection. So we decided to investigate the role of the fusion protein or the role of the fission protein. So we performed RNI on the mitofusin, and we could show that if you do RNI on mitofusin 1 and 2, what is clearly occurring is that the bacteria, the cells have mitochondria which are totally pre-fragmented, and the infection is much less efficient. In contrast, if you take cells where you inhibit the expression of DRP1, then the cells have a network of mitochondria which is really highly filamentous, and you see that if you infect cells with that, you increase the level of infection. So our interpretation is that the impact of infection on a pre-filamentous network is a benefit for infection, that Listeria can have a strong impact if the mitochondria are filamentous. So we have started to study the process of fragmentation by Listeria, and we could show that in fact the fission protein DRP1 is absent from mitochondria, which was totally unexpected. Because when you take cells and you induce fragmentation by another means, the DRP1 is colocalizing with the mitochondria. In the case of Listeria monocytogenes, somehow DRP1 disappears. So the process of mitochondrial fragmentation has been well studied and is well studied and is shown to be mediated by DRP1, but also pre-mediated by the ER. And ER somehow marks the site of mitochondrial fragmentation. So we were wondering whether in the case of the fragmentation by Listeria, the ER would also mark the mitochondria. And as you can see here, the ER is clearly marking the mitochondria at site of fragmentation. So we have a novel type of fragmentation mechanism, which is not using DRP1, and we have shown that by using cells where DRP1 is knocked out, but which is still using the ER. So the conclusion is that really, mitochondria are transiently fragmented by a totally unconventional mechanism that we are studying for the moment. Another aspect of our research deals with post-translational modification in the host. We have been recently interested in post-translational modification because modification of protein activities by post-translational modification can occur locally, quickly, and specifically. There are different types of post-translational modification, some which are reversible, most of them are reversible, and some of them which are irreversible. Irreversible in the case of proteolysis, but also in the case of deamidation or elimination. But reversible is well known, like phosphorylation, acetylation, methylation, AMPylation, etc. So we have been interested in one specific post-translational modification, which is sumoylation. We were interested in sumoylation because sumoylation is generally affecting nuclear protein, it's affecting a protein involved in genome stability, in transcription regulation, all kinds of pathways which might be important for the infectious process. So what was known before our study on the interference of pathogen with the sumo pathway? Well, in the case of viruses, it has been shown that many viral proteins can be sumoylated. It has also been shown that there is a virus, an adenovirus, which produces a protein which leads to the degradation of E1 enzyme. I should say that sumo is a small ubiquitin-like modifier, and like ubiquitin, sumo modification is induced by three enzymes, E1, E2, and E3. In fact, in the case of sumo, E3 is not so much required as in the ubiquitin pathway. So to come back to this virus, This virus expresses a protein which leads to the degradation of the E1 protein. There is also the Kaposi virus, which expresses an E3 enzyme which leads to the sumoylation of proteins in mammalian cells. In the case of bacteria, there is only one example where it has been described an interference with the sumo pathway, and this is in the case of Xanthomonas, where there are proteins which are encoding desumoylases. So we decided to look at sumoylated protein upon listeria infection, and we could show that if you incubate cells with light-type listeria, there is a global desumoylation, which occurs in the case of the two isoforms of sumo, sumo 1 and sumo 2. So we were interested to decipher what are the listeria protein responsible for this desumoylation. So we use a variety of listeria mutant, and we could show that if you use the delta INLA or the eterline B mutant, there is no effect on the desumoylation. But if you on the desumoylation obtained with the wild type. But if you use the delta HLY, delta LLO mutant, here we have no longer a desumoylation of the protein. So this indicated that LLO, here again, is responsible for the loss of sumo-conjugated protein. So we decided to do the same experiment with the purified protein. So we incubate cells with LLO, and we analyze the sumo 1 or sumo 2, 3 conjugated protein. As you can see, there is a global desumoylation. So since there was a global desumoylation of the protein, we were wondering whether the LLO did not have an effect on the sumoylation machinery itself. And as shown here by David Ribé in my lab, listeriolysinol triggers the degradation of the E2 enzyme UBC9. So LLO-treated cells have a normal E1 enzyme, but in that case, the UBC9, the E2 enzyme, is totally degraded, and that leads to global desumoylation. So, of course, it was of interest to know whether this was playing a role in infection, and we decided to overexpress sumo in cells to see whether having a lot of sumoylated protein would prevent infection. So we overexpress sumo 1 or sumo 2 in cells, and then we infect with listeria, and then we treat with gentamicin, as we do in gentamicin classical assay, and then we lyse the infected cells, and we quantify the number of intracellular bacteria. So when we overexpress sumo 1 or sumo 2, we have a lot of proteins compared to the wild type, and we could show that in these conditions, you have less infection. Clearly, there is less infection. So clearly, sumoylated protein play a role in infection, counteract the infection. Listeria blocks the host cell sumoylation to promote its infection through degradation of the host sumoenzyme UBC9. Of course, we are now interested to decipher how this occurs. We are interested to know what are the signaling events which lead to the degradation of UBC9? And we have shown that, in fact, an aspartyl protease sensitive is responsible for this degradation. And we are also searching what are the sumoylated proteins which counteract the infection. And we have undertaken a big mass spec search for this protein. And I don't have time to tell you the beginning of our results. So I would like to switch to the last part of this talk and talk about the effect of listeria on chromatin and epigenetic regulation. So what is chromatin? Chromatin is the structure which is important for packaging the DNA in the nucleus. So the basic unit of the chromatin is the nucleosome. The nucleosome is made of an octamer of histones that you can see here. And what is important is that the DNA is wrapped around the nucleosome. So in the nucleus, either the nucleosomes are tightly packed, and in that case, one talks about heterochromatin, or they are loosely packed, and when talked about euchromatin. The heterochromatin is transcriptionally silent, but the euchromatin is transcriptionally active. An important feature of this lab is that it shows that the N-terminus of the histone, is available for post-translational modification, which play a critical role in the recruitment of accessory protein, including transcription factor. So we have been able to identify a bacterial protein which targets a listerial protein which targets a chromatin silencing complex. So how did we do that? As I previously told you during this talk, when we sequence the genome of Listeria monocytogenes and the genome of Listeria inocula, we were interested to decipher genes which are present in monocytogenes and are absent in Listeria inocula to identify new virulence factors. One of those genes is LNTA. So LNTA is present in L monocytogenes and absent in Listeria inocula. LNTA encodes for a small protein that we wanted to analyze. So first, we deleted the gene for LNTA and we could show that deletion affects the virulence. So LNTA is a virulence factor. Then we analyzed where LNTA was going during infection. So we tagged LNTA and we could show that LNTA is a protein which, when the bacteria are intracellular, LNTA goes to the nucleus, as you can see here, with human fibroblasts infected for 24 hours with LNTA expressing Listeria. So LNTA is a protein which goes to the nucleus, and this is the first protein of Listeria which goes to the nucleus. So to address the role of this protein, we decided to identify the protein which interacts with LNTA. So we carried out a two-hybrid screen and we fished a protein which is called BHD1. So BHD1 is a protein which has a BH domain, and this is the only characteristic of this protein, which was totally unknown when we identified it as an interactor of LNTA. So since it was unknown, since it was interacting with LNTA, since it was interacting with LNTA, which is a protein of Listeria going to the nucleus, we decided to study the interactors of BHD1 in the mammalian cells. And what we found is that the BHD1 protein interacts with several components which were previously shown as being involved in chromatin compaction and gene silencing. So BHD1 interacts, for example, with HP1, with HDAC, with MBD1. So all these proteins are involved in chromatin compaction. So we decided to verify whether BHD1 is really inducing compaction. So we overexpress BHD1, and this, as shown is here, stimulates heterochromatin formation compared to wild-type X cells on the left of this panel. You see that in transfected cells, a lot of these dark spots are due to heterochromatin formation. So to summarize, LNTA is a protein which is secreted in the cytosol of infected cells and can go to the nucleus and interact with BHD1, which is a chromatin silencing factor. So what is the role of the interaction during infection? What is the role of LNTA-BHD1 interaction during infection? Does BHD1 repress transcription during Listeria infection? If LNTA is not expressed, like shown on the left of this panel, and does LNTA change expression of BHD1 target genes if LNTA is expressed by Listeria? So to address this question, we have compared gene expression in cells infected with Listeria not expressing LMTA, we compare gene expression with cells infected with Listeria expressing LMTA. What we could show is first, if Listeria infects cells, interestingly, and we had not shown that before, there is production of interferon type 3. Interferon lambda genes are induced in epithelial cells in response to infection. This was a result that was very new for us. We did not know that in epithelial cells, interferon type 3 is expressed. In absence of LMTA, the BHD1 complex represses interferon-stimulated genes. Indeed, when you have production of an interferon, normally you have production of interferon-stimulated genes. But we have been able to show that these genes are repressed by BHD1. But interestingly, when LMTA is expressed, interferon type 3 is expressed, but the interferon-stimulated genes in that case are also expressed because LMTA is desequestering BHD1 from the site where it was inducing a repression. So when present, LMTA impairs BHD1 recruitment to ISGs and stimulates their expression. So this study has led to three discoveries. First, BHD1. BHD1, a new component of a heterochromatin silencing complex, as I've been showing you. This study has led to the discovery of LMTA, a new Listeria virulence factor, which targets the heterochromatin machinery. And this study has also shown that Listeria in epithelial cell induces a strong level of interferon lambda, and this leads to a new immune pathway which is induced during this bacterial infection, and we have shown that this is also the case for other bacterial infections. So epigenetic regulation is modulated by the nucleosome, by the chromatin structure. It is also regulated by histone modification. And several years ago, we have shown that Listeria monocytogenes via LLO induces the dephosphorylation of histone H3 and the deacetylation of histone H4, and this leads to transcriptional regulation of a subset of those genes, including the downregulation of key immunity genes. More recently, we have shown that this pathway is regulated by potassium efflux during the process of infection. But for the moment, we don't know what are the phosphatase or the deacetylates which are regulating this histone modification. In contrast, we have shown recently that when Listeria infects cells via the NLB pathway, the NLB, which you remember, interact with the MET receptor, we have shown that in that case, there is a signaling event which leads to the translocation of the deacetylase, SIRT2, which goes to the nucleus and leads to the deacetylation of histone H3 at position 18. And this deacetylation leads to a global repression of a number of genes which are critical for infection. Why do I say that they are critical for infection? I say that because we have been able to use SIRT2 mice, and we could show that the SIRT2 knockout mice were more resistant than the wild-type mice, indicating that Listeria is really exploiting the property of the SIRT2 protein for an efficient infection. So this last example, I've shown you that chromatin regulation and bacterial infectious disease are an emerging field. I mean, the role of infection or the interaction between bacteria and chromatin modification, histone modification, is really a concept that was not really perceived several years ago. And I think there is a lot to be learned about the study of chromatin, histone modification, transcription and regulation, etc. One hypothesis that we have currently in the lab is that maybe there are some chromatin marks which are deposited by bacteria during infection and could stay for a while in cells which have been infected with listeria, and we are trying to decipher whether this is a possibility in some cell types. So this is my last take-home message. Listeria reprogrammed the host transcription, and epigenetics and infection is really an emerging field. So I have told you a lot of little vignettes corresponding to our studies of the infectious process. I have told you about really interaction between the host and the bacteria. I've also told you about more specific pathway in the bacteria or more specific pathway in the cells. And I would just like to remind you what I've said. I've told you that Listeria virulence genes are thermoregulated via an RNA thermosensor, which allows expression of virulence genes only at high temperature. I have shown you that regulation in bacteria is much more sophisticated than originally thought. We have riboswitches which regulate non-coding RNAs, which can also sequester the regulatory protein. We have shown that antisense RNA can be of different nature, like this excludome concept that I told you, where an antisense can play the role of an antisense and also of a messenger RNA. I have shown you that during the entry process, there is a specific interaction between internalin and human icadherin, and I've shown you that the use of human icadherin transgenic mice has allowed to show that listeria crosses the intestinal barrier via an internalin icadherin interaction. The crossing of the placental barrier, incidentally, is mediated by both the NLA pathway and the NLB pathway. The study of these signaling events during entry of listeria in two cells has led to the discovery of a new role for clathrin in orchestrating actin rearrangements. Inhibition of clathrin prevents the actin rearrangements. So clathrin should not be considered as solely involved in endocytosis of small molecules or small objects, but clathrin is involved in orchestrating actin rearrangements during the entry of big objects or during the adhesion between a bacterium and a cell, and also, as we have shown, during cell-cell adhesion. The bacterial protein ACTA was instrumental in the discovery of the function of the ARP2-3 complex, the major actin inhibitor in mammalian cells. Septins, which are protein-making filaments, can entrap cytosolic bacteria and prevent dissemination. Mitochondria are transiently fragmented by an unconventional mechanism, and we have shown that this transient fragmentation is absolutely critical for an efficient process. Finally, I've shown you that listeria blocks the sumoylation of mammalian proteins to promote infection through the degradation of the host sumo enzyme UBC9. And in the last part of this talk, I've shown you that listeria reprogram the host transcription via different mechanisms acting on epigenetic regulators, and really epigenetics and infection is an emerging field. So I have told you that we use listeria as a model for addressing a lot of aspects. We think it's now a reference in different areas of biology. In microbiology, we have shown different types of gene regulation by various RNAs. We have addressed new types of virulence factors, new virulence mechanisms. We have shown that listeria reveal how bacteria maximally exploit cellular function. In cell biology, we have studied the actin base motility, actin dynamics, phagocytosis, endocytosis, cell adhesion and signaling, membrane plasticity. I didn't have time to talk about the role of RAS during entry. I talk about mitochondrial dynamic, post-insertion modification. The study of listeria has led to the discovery of really new concepts and new components in cell biology. I think listeria has been one of the bacteria which has been the most exploited as far as comparative genomics is concerned. We also have done a lot of transcriptomics. We decipher the first operon map. We have shown a lot of non-coding RNAs, and we are now showing a lot of new concepts in RNA biology. Listeria has been used to show that bacteria can remodel chromatin, can induce histone modification, and this field is wide open for new discoveries. We are not studying too much immunology, but we have still shown that interferon type 3 is produced during infection. And others have worked on T-cell response and used Listeria as a live vaccine to present foreign antigen. So in molecular medicine, we have deciphered the mechanism underlying the crossing of the intestinal barrier or the placental barrier. And clearly, Listeria has been really a tool in many, many aspects of biology. Of course, all this could not be done without a lot of funding from different agencies, in particular Institut Pasteur, INSERM and INRA, to which my unit is belonging, from ERC, the Weizmann Pasteur Fund, from the EU, from the ANR, HFSP, Fondation Louis Janté, from HHMI, the Fondation pour la Recherche Médicale, and from Danone. So with that, I thank you very much.